David, go back here.
We
have an ambitious plan to turn the museum into the most recognized institution in the United
Kingdom. How are you?
You're very much friend. You are my adopted family. This is Lord Alton. He has given me the honor of being one tonight.
Mine is the honor.
It's a wonderful book. I'm delighted to be able to join you.
It's an honor for you to
And you are launching a book on some of the most impressive art in the country, one of the most impressive buildings.
Ladies and gentlemen, can I please introduce Lord Adonis?
Ladies and gentlemen, I'm sorry to speak so early in the proceedings when there are still people arriving, but unfortunately I have to leave in a moment or two. But I wanted to say a very warm word of congratulations to Professor Khalili on the publication of his quite outstanding book. The symbolism of publishing a book on so much of the best in Islamic art and architecture in what is one of the jewels in the crown of English art and architecture, I think, is a very happy meeting of cultures. It's not entirely a happy coincidence, because, of course, this is also the building from which King Charles I, who assembled one of the greatest royal collections in the world, and what is still the bedrock of much of the royal collections here in England. This is the building from which, of course, he stepped out to be executed in 1649. So it has very mixed associations for us English and for those who are great art lovers. But it is a fantastic book that David has produced. It's a tribute to his own painstaking work in assembling his collection and the great team that he has that does it. It's a tribute to his own commitments to the cause of education and culture that he's produced this book, and it will be an immensely valuable resource for students, for general readers, for those who have a deep knowledge of Islamic art and architecture, and indeed for those like myself who don't, and who are regarding it as a remarkable learning experience, reading the book. If I may say so, it is beautifully produced. It's one of the most beautifully produced books of its kind I've seen. Your publisher has done a fantastic job, and we should congratulate the publisher. It's also very accessible for the general reader, and the marvellous wheel at the back, for those of you who haven't seen it yet, which gives you the guided tour of all of the Islamic countries of the world with their populations, their flags, their vital statistics, I suspect will be of great use to students in many different contexts. To have all of this in one book, so readily accessible, which Professor Khalili is generously making available to schools which have have students that would wish to take advantage of it. And I believe it's going to come out soon in paperback too, so it'll be at a price that's widely affordable. I think it's a great achievement. And I just wanted to say that I regard it as a great thing that you've done. I think it will be very widely and warmly received. And on behalf of all of your guests here this evening, I just wanted to say a word of very warm congratulations to you. Thank you.
My family is here now too. My cousin is here. It's fantastic.
Hi, Dave. How are you? Very nice to see you. What a wonderful night. What a beautiful book.
Well, it's a book for minutes.
Oh, yes, you're very good.
It was lovely, marvelously very good. But anyway, it's a, you do so much.
He's the boss. Yes. He's the boss.
You hear that?
I'm going to take over. I'm becoming decoration.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, sure.
Not that late.
You are not in Ogoy.
God bless you.
The ambassadors of the ambassadors. He's the longest lasting ambassador of the United Kingdom. Yeah. He's the chairman of the core of ambassadors of the United Kingdom.
That's very good of you to invite me. You've got a lot of guests here.
Ladies and gentlemen, Your Excellencies, my Lords, ladies and gentlemen, may I introduce Lord Bhatia of Hampton, Chairman of the Muslim Research Centre, British Muslim Research Centre.
Your Excellencies, my Lords, ladies and gentlemen, distinguished guests. It's my honor and a privilege to welcome you all to this reception today. We've come here to celebrate the launch of the publication of the Timeline History of Islamic Arts and Architecture by Professor David Khalili. Let me say a few words about David before he is introduced to and asked to come and speak to us. Those of us who know David will agree that he is an unusual person with many skills and attributes. Those of you who have not met him before will learn about him today through this publication and when he speaks about his work. I know him as an outstanding champion of peace, education and culture. Let me elaborate. His passion is Islamic art, and I consider him as an art collector on an epic scale. Over the last 35 years, He has accumulated more than 25,000 objects of Islamic arts. According to John Rogers, who was the deputy keeper in the Department of Oriental Antiquities in the British Museum between 1977 and 1990, he said, "This is the largest, most comprehensive collection of Islamic art in private hands in the world, with works covering 1,400 years, an area from Spain to China." David is an ardent collector, a restorer, a researcher, a publisher, and an exhibitor of Islamic arts. Over the years, he has assembled a team of experts who work under him, or should I say work with him, to establish this epic collection here in London. David believes, and I agree with him, that the racial hatred is often simply a result of ignorance or misunderstanding, and the time is now right to educate people, especially children, by combining art with interfaith studies. An appreciation of art is probably one of the only qualities shared among the whole mankind, igniting a passion that is subconsciously part of each and every one of us. I have heard David say quite often that although religion and politics have their own language, the language of art is universal and can unite the hearts and minds of mankind and across all frontiers. David currently does this, and those of us who know him, we know how easily he crosses the divide between faiths and races seamlessly and brings people together. Before I conclude, I have a present duty to perform, and I'd like to read out two messages that have come this afternoon from some very important people. The first message is from the Prime Minister, who unfortunately cannot be with us here because I think there's a visiting Prime Minister from Germany. Mike O'Brien, if you have a moment, tell him that he's got to work out his priorities right. He should be here instead of meeting the Prime Minister of Germany. But we are very grateful to him for sending us this message. The Prime Minister writes as follows. Dear Professor Khalili, I'm delighted to send my best wishes for the official launch of the Timeline History of Islamic Art and Architecture. The launch of this publication gives us all an important opportunity to reflect on the influence and contribution that Islam has made to Britain and the rest of the world. Islamic art and architecture has been and is one of the richest trends in our universal heritage. By covering the subject in detail, this book will help to enhance our understanding of this area and bring an appreciation of Islamic art and its history to a wider audience. With best wishes for the enjoyable evening. A second message has arrived from the Clarence House. Dear Professor Khalili, the Prince of Wales has asked me to write to thank you so much for the copy of your splendid new book, The Timeline History of Islamic Art and Architecture, which was delivered to this office last week. His Royal Highness was deeply touched by the sentiments you expressed on the title page and looks forward very much to dipping into the book at the earliest opportunity. This comes with the Prince of Wales's warmest good wishes. Yours sincerely, James Kidner. Ladies and gentlemen, thank you very much for being with us tonight. It's a great pleasure to receive you here. And this shows the kind of magnet that David works with, that people from different faiths, different races, different countries can be here on a late Thursday evening to be with us here. Thank you very much.
May I introduce, representing the Foreign Secretary, the Honourable Mike O'Brien, QC, MP and Solicitor General.
Thank you very much. It's very pleasant to be here today, and I would like to extend my thanks to Professor Nasser David Khalili for the invitation to attend the launch of what is, I think, an important book, The Timeline History of Islamic Art and Architecture. We live in challenging times. With the tragic events of 9/11, the Madrid bombings, the horrors of the 7th of July in London, and the recent bombings in Jordan, there are many who argue that Islam and the West are inherently incompatible. Some, like Professor Samuel Huntington, warn us that the clash of civilizations is inevitable. And of course, the terrorists say that too. But these people forget about the long-standing interaction between the West and Islam. The impact of Islamic civilization on the West over the centuries has been visible in many arenas, from language to mathematics to medicine. Indeed, Islam, Muslims, and Britain have been tied together in many ways. Jewels in the history of Islam, like Sayyid Amir Ali, the poet Muhammad Iqbal, and the translator of the Quran, Abdullah Yusuf Ali, all had links to Britain. And of course, 2 million Muslims today contribute to every walk of life in Britain. And that is why it is important to challenge the myth of otherness about Islam. To be British today is to be part of a multicultural society, and we are all stronger as a country because of our diversity. Therefore, we know that claims that Islam and the West are incompatible are simply wrong. However, we sometimes need a universal language which can cross boundaries and reach people, no matter what their creed, race, or religion. Art and architecture are one such universal language. To paraphrase President John F. Kennedy, where power leads man towards arrogance, art and poetry reminds him of his limitations. When government narrows the area of man's concern, art and poetry reminds him of the richness and the diversity of his existence. Where power corrupts, art cleanses. Islamic art and architecture is no different in its universality. It reaches across in a language that we can all understand and appreciate. That language is the language of beauty. I know that many great Muslim artists and architects, like the great Sinan, the builder of the Sulaimaniyah Mosque, along with Sufis like Rumi, have argued that Allah is beautiful and he in turn loves beauty. This message of beauty is one that resonates across Islamic art and architecture, from the mud-built Sankore Mosque in Timbuktu to the seminal marble-clad masterpiece of the Taj Mahal. And it is this universal language that Professor Khalili's beautiful book portrays in its true splendor to the wider world. A message conveyed through his generosity in arranging for 5,000 copies of the book to be distributed to schools and to colleges, both here in the UK and overseas. Through appreciation of Islamic art and architecture, we can also learn to appreciate the culture, the religion, and the civilization that gave birth to it. This can only help to bring us together in recognizing that the supposed clash of civilizations for what it truly is. It is a mere myth. What unites us, brings us closer to God, is greater than that which divides us. Let me finally thank Professor Khalili on behalf of all of us for his invaluable contribution to mutual understanding between different cultures and worlds, and for helping us to see that what we all share in our recognition of beauty is something which we also all share in our common humanity. Congratulations on the book, and thank you for inviting me today.
Ladies and gentlemen, may I now introduce Professor Khalili, author of The Timeline and founder of the Khalili Collections.
Lord Batia, I feel very humble listening to your kind words. Thank you very much. Your Excellencies, Minister, my lords, ladies and gentlemen, the Prime Minister has encapsulated the reason why we are all here tonight. I'm often asked, what is Islamic art? The term Islamic art broadly describes work produced by Muslim artists for Muslim patrons. It does not imply that the art is exclusively religious in content or use. It is Islamic because its artistic vocabulary is partly rooted in a Muslim philosophy and shaped to some extent by the spirit and doctrine of the Muslim faith. Unlike Christian art, which is mostly religious, Islamic art is mostly secular. This book describes achievements in astronomy, chemistry, engineering, mathematics, and medicine during a time when most of Europe was struggling to emerge from the Dark Ages. I believe that the real weapon of mass destruction is ignorance, which is why I want this book to create an awareness amongst Muslims and non-Muslims alike. I'm hoping that it will become a passport of both pride and dignity to the Muslims worldwide, whose science and culture has contributed enormously to the culture and art of the West. I have been lecturing around the world for the last 15 years on this subject, and I was astonished by people coming to me afterward and telling me, "Are you serious to tell us that what we saw on screen and the description you gave is something Islamic? And where can we find a book where we could see what you said, which is chronologically, geographically, and artistically explaining this magnificent heritage?" So it dawned on me that it would be a very good idea to do something as a gift for my own birthday. So 3 years ago, I decided that I would sit down and write the book. As some of you may know, I'm also chairman of the Maimonides Foundation, a joint Jewish-Muslim interfaith organization which fosters understanding, dialogue, and cooperation between Jews and Muslims through cultural, academic, and educational programs. In my role as a chairman, as you have heard from the minister, I plan to donate copies of the timeline in the Arabic, which is because we are translating this book into 25, probably 30 languages, to the Palestinian schools in Gaza and the West Bank. I'm also donating copies to Muslim and non-Muslim schools in this country and abroad. Allow me to say that where we are, whether we are Jewish, Christian, Muslim, or indeed of any other faith, we are all children of Adam and Eve. It is God's command that we should learn about each other's way of life and respect it. In conclusion, I'm going to repeat what the minister eloquently explained to you. A verse by Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, which says in Arabic, إِنَّ اللَّهُ جَمِيلًا وَيُحِبُّهُ الْجَمَالِ. Truly, God is beautiful and loves all beauty. Thank you for coming, and God bless you all.
May I now introduce His Excellency Dr. Syed Mohammad Hosseini Adeli, the Iranian Ambassador.
Excellencies, my lords, ministers, ladies and gentlemen, it's a real pleasure to say a few words as Ambassador of Iran and Ambassador of a Muslim country, though leaving very soon, and fellow Iranian also. I would like to take this opportunity to express our appreciation and gratitude to Professor Khalili for this very valuable contribution he has made to the Islamic culture. Indeed, we think that this is something that would contribute to the notion of dialogue among civilization instead of clash among civilization. What we need today is dialogue among civilization. And civilizations are understood through culture and through literature. What is in front of us now, before us, this valuable publication, would really promote the understanding of Islam and promote the culture of dialogue amongst civilization. I was thinking that having served the Islamic culture for the 35 years, Professor Khalili should indeed be conferred upon him the title of Ambassador of Culture, or Cultural Ambassador, and Ambassador of Culture of Islam, so that he would be accepted also in the Club of Ambassadors. And we would be very much honored to have such Ambassador of Culture amongst us. I would like to once again thank you for our invitation, for inviting us, and also express our heartfelt congratulations to you. We are sure that this valuable publication would serve as an invaluable source for all of those who are interested in the dialogue of civilization in understanding Islam. Thank you very much.
Congratulations.